black, white, or Latina, which one would you choose? And better yet, which one do you assume would do better on these? Merriam-Webster Dictionary defines diversity as the inclusion of different types of people, while the colloquial resource Urban Dictionary defines diversity in more common terms as anyone other than a white guy. While neither definition accurately encompasses what it means to be diverse as a whole, neither source classifies diversity as an adjective. T.C. Williams High School, as the only public high school in the city of Alexandria, is frequently in the news as the most diverse in the area. Students are asked to identify race on surveys, standardized tests, and school records as a means of qualifying, categorizing, and identifying who they are as scholars. This data is then used to formulate the diverse TC, where diversity is the modifying adjective for our school. Theogony looked at this modifier on a deeper level, investigating what it really means to be diverse at TC, and how our diversity is more than just our defining adjective. Stay tuned. TC is 39% African American, 30% Hispanic, 22% white, and 7% Asian Pacific Islander, and 2% unspecified. The school accommodates students from 7 racially and culturally diverse neighborhoods. As a conglomeration of societies, the students merge in the hallways, bringing their ideas of diversity, inclusion, exclusion, and stereotypes with them. These omnipresent notions carry a silent sway when choosing classes, higher education, friendships, and life goals. TC has categorized its students around these notions, asking them to check their race on exams, enter it on surveys, and has thus become a home to a statistical melting pot. But is that all we are?
Well, depending, you have the chance, and then you have the black people, and then you have the, you know, regular people.
You see, we're in the cafeteria right now, and if you look around, people are grouped by race, honestly.
Whites, blacks, Asians, and other ethnicities walk the halls of many American high schools. Since the 1960s, diversity has been a staple in the American public education system.
Above all, the races mix fairly well, I would say.
Some people choose not to hang around outside of their race.
In classes, there's not a white section and a black section. I think people get along really well.
People feel more comfortable with their own race.
Many schools pride themselves on having students of different cultures, beliefs, backgrounds, and perspectives intermingling over test papers and football fields alike.
I would say there's too much diversity for people to be discriminated against. Like,
They're going to be looking stupid by themselves if they try to do that.
It's so intertwined. It's like there's so many different people.
At T.C. Williams High School in Alexandria, Virginia, 39% of the student population classifies themselves as African American, 30% as Hispanic or Latino, and 22% as white Anglo-Saxon. Though a statistical melting pot, the students have expressed lingering divides.
Some racial slurs I've heard, well,
cracker.
The N-word.
This is awkward.
I've heard things like, you should be good at basketball because you're black.
Spick.
I've heard chant, but that's about it.
Negro.
Like, a lot of the racial slurs happen with, like, Hispanics, usually.
Arab.
Porch monkey, that's, like, one of the weird ones.
I've heard kike for Jewish people.
I mean, I've heard things to the extent of friends talking to friends, like, jokingly saying it back and forth.
We do hear a lot of people being called, like, Oreos and things like that, like, people of multicultural races trying to act white.
The existence and prominence of racial slurs show the lingering effects of how color and culture have created a fractious society.
People usually live with their own race.
I like everyone. If you're, you know, black, Spanish, white, green, yellow, whatever, I don't care if you're gay or whatever.
I think the races mix pretty well. Of course, there's going to be cliques, and they usually do stand in their own kind of group most of the time. But in classrooms, they mix quite well.
It depends. Like, I've had AP classes where I've been, like, one of, like, a small number of, you know, multicultural background people. And the only time I feel uncomfortable is when, like, the teachers openly, like, point it out.
I hear a lot of jokes and slurs about, like, my race and stuff. And sometimes it gets kind of annoying. But usually stuff you can put up with and stuff you can laugh about.
Though TC student body claims it is colorblind, the opportunity to see the beauty in every color or culture is something that school works towards every day. Hello, and joining us today is Superintendent of ACPS, Dr. Morton Sherman.
Good to see you again.
Thank you. And as well, some of the voices of TC, we have senior Ty Mooney. Welcome to the show. And we have sophomore Abigail Sullivan. Welcome to the show.
Hello.
And then here on my right is, junior, right?
Yes.
Jacob Poloski. And senior Tyrus Morris, welcome to the show.
I'm glad to be here.
All right, so to begin very quickly, in one sentence, how would you define diversity as it applies to TC? Anyone can start.
You want me to start?
Dr. Sherman, please.
In one sentence. Mm-hmm. Diversity for TC, I think, is seen as a badge of honor. We are diverse. We have representatives from many different races and different levels of wealth and mm-hmm. poverty. Traditional, straightforward definition, which I'm sure we'll come back to.
We definitely will. And as students, how would you define diversity? You don't have to give me what they've told you in history or in English, but what you feel.
Well,
you can be more than one sentence.
Okay, that's good.
Tyrus.
Well, diversity, that's one of the main things that makes up the school, really. I think really it might be a little hard to give the definition because we're so used to it. We're mm-hmm. so used to seeing all these different type of cultures. And I mean, you can kind of give the blame to where we live, you know, near the Capitol. So we have a lot of people come here, different races and whatnot. But diversity here is just... it's in abundance, I'll say that.
It's in abundance, I like that.
I think TC is a melting pot for many cultures. I think that the diversity here is very wide range. We have multiple races, like you said, and we're more tolerant of each other than what I would say in other regions are, because there's more of us here.
I agree. Ty or Jacob, weigh in?
Sure, I was just gonna say, you can also see diversity not only as like a racial thing, but like a social thing or an interest thing. Like mm-hmm. you don't have to be a different race. You don't have to have different races that have diversity. You can have people with different interests or different,
goals.
Yeah, goals, exactly, to have diversity.
Yeah, I like that in how it's like not just a race thing and how it can also apply to like other aspects of a person, like religion and goals and interests, which TC has almost everything, which is really great.
I agree. And so since we do have everything or everybody, so to speak, TC uses these myriad definitions, whether it be an abundance or whether it be a culture, in a more simplistic way. Diversity is the immediate qualifier for any mass group of data. So a mass group of data is often considered diverse if it is several different levels. And in statistics, how does TC use diversity as a qualifying adjective? So to clarify that question a little bit, I know everybody, the students have checked on exam, black, white, Asian, whatnot, to precede their scores when scoring their papers. How does TC use that? How many instances have you had to check your race for something?
Like today, we had to take some.
It was a state test.
Yeah, it was a state test to help people see how we did in school, what our mm-hmm. families were like, and what we did outside of school for community service, clubs, and sports. And at the very beginning, they asked us what our race was.
Yeah.
Just along with, they do that with any kind of anonymous test.
They do use your race instead of your name for some of those. That's interesting. Has anybody else had an experience, and Dr. Sherman, I do want you to weigh in on why ACPS mm-hmm. does this, where they've had to check their race that was not an exam?
Actually, mm-hmm. lately, a while ago, I guess, when seniors applying to colleges, you put your race down for a lot of colleges use affirmative action as something that could help or maybe hurt you getting into a college, so I put that down.
So oh, yeah. That's for, the thing. For jobs, too. Remember job. Dunkin' Donuts asked me.
Really?
Yeah, really. They asked me what my race was, and I thought that was weird. Mm-hmm. Like, they needed to know, but yeah.
Right. And Dr. Sherman, can I ask you why?
I'm really struck by the Dunkin' Donuts. If they asked your race, that seems
yeah,
a little inappropriate.
I mean,
they made a decision based upon race to hire you or not?
Well, I actually didn't get hired, but I don't
know. So now we have another issue on the table, yeah.
I don't think it was because of race. I just think it's, why would they need to know? I think it was, a lot of other things would matter a lot more.
Well, yeah, some private industries, private companies have affirmative action plans where they try to hire, whether it's women, you know, by gender or by race, and the only way they would know that is to reach out. In schools, we don't do that. Going back to your question, Laura. In fact, universities are often, when you talk about applying for college and checking, that's for scholarship purposes. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of questions, even at Michigan right now, which is one of the lead schools in trying to establish quotas to say that we want a certain percentage of whites, a certain percentage of Latinos, and a certain percentage of African Americans in admissions. For ACPS, a lot of the times when we ask, for example, the test you talked about was a state test. That's required. A lot of the times when we ask your race or your gender, it's for state funding or for federal funding. It's actually required for us to report it. And so for poverty as well, whether or not children at the lower grades particularly or in free and reduced lunch are eligible based upon their level of family's wealth. So a lot of that is to determine on the one hand, what we can provide to the schools through federal funding, and then on the other hand, it's an accountability system, that wonderful misguided law, No Child Left Behind, absolutely demands that we list by gender, by race, and report out results by group, and then we get assessed. And even now Virginia has switched, where there's three different categories, and then we have to report that out. And schools that don't do well in one of the subgroups can get punished for that.
Interesting. So you can be punished if your percentage of African American or students on free and reduced lunch do not pass.
That's what happened when TC Williams became a one of the schools listed as persistently lowest achieving. Our special ed population, another category you haven't even mentioned yet, was one of the areas that was very low, as were our Latino students, our ELO students.
Interesting. And I do want to open that up now to, do you believe that TC is more than our racial racial breakdown? Because we are judged so intimately based on that, like how well we're doing as a school. So what is, so can we be defined by a racial breakdown? Should we even be defined?
I don't think we should be defined by racial breakdown, because there's intelligence in all of us. It doesn't matter what race, what culture we come from. We have different minds. We see things differently, and we experience different things. So I think to judge someone based on race, or to just judge a school based on how much they have of that race, isn't judging them on the quality of students that they have and the quality of education that they're providing.
I agree. Does anybody else weigh in?
I agree completely.
Tyrus, I know a few years ago you did a video about with African American students about how they felt in school. So you want to speak on perhaps why you chose to do that and how that relates to us being judged by a racial breakdown?
Well, I think what this whole thing is about is, you know, different races and how they feel. That's why you gathered us all here today. I was doing something just for, you know, my personal race. I don't know if that's selfish or not, but just to increase exposure, the knowledge of how my race feels, African Americans in school, you know, how our connection with our teacher is, how our interaction between different students is, and how that affects us and how we view it and how it kind of really affects our school life, you know? The reasons that you asked why I did it?
Yes, perhaps you did interview a certain subcategory of students who are included in this racial breakdown to see how they felt, if they felt marginalized or if they felt any other way. Why? What motivated that?
The motivation behind that, in all honesty, was personal experience. There's a few times, you know, in different schools, I've been to a few different schools where I felt like I was left to just this stereotype of the African American child, whether it be good or bad, whether it be, oh, he's black, you know, he knows about, you know, black history or whatever. It's been times where I've gone to a school and Black history was kind of left out. I don't know if we, because it is a Black school, I guess we felt like it's Black history all the time. We don't need to study it, or maybe the school's so diverse that it was left behind.
Right.
Either way, I felt like, you know, Black history needs to be, its awareness needs to be raised. I hope I answered your question.
You did, and that actually brings me to my next question, which is, how does TC approach Black history and Hispanic Heritage Months? Should there be perhaps a White History Month to make it even? Should there be a Jewish History Month? What do you guys, and feel free to weigh in on that. I know it's a very sensitive issue amongst students and administrators alike.
I personally think that Black History Month and Latino and all the different races, I think that designating a month for them only increases some racial problems. I think that we all want equality. Mm-hmm. And if you have 1 month dedicated to this race and not dedicated to another, that can cause a problem. But why dedicate a month when you can just dedicate every day yourself? You're supposed to take hold of what you are. You're supposed to stand for what you are and what you believe. It shouldn't take you a month to do it. It should take you 365 days. It should take you every minute that you have, because it's who you are. It's what right. you are. It's not a month of the year.
You're not white for a month.
So if that's the ideal, and I think we'd all agree to that, that's the ideal, every day we should honor and respect one another.
Yes.
Right? Mm-hmm. But do you understand how we got to that point as a country as to why we have a designated month for Black History Month or a designated Latino?
Because, personally, I think it's because people who... Slavery was a big thing here in America, especially down south.
Well, this is the south, right here.
Yeah.
We were above the Mason-Dixon line.
No, yeah. We're below the Mason-Dixon line, but we're a southern city, the longest occupied southern city in the Civil War. Yes,
things that I missed in U.S. history. There you go.
I've talked to your teachers.
I'm from North Carolina, so that's a little bit more.
But we hold claim to the
South.
To the capital of the Confederacy in Virginia.
Yeah, you
do. This is Virginia's the South.
It's just, I don't know, maybe moving up a state was a little hard for me to kind of take.
Going north, huh?
Yeah.
But you know how we got to the point of having to designate a month, or.
Why don't you tell us how this came about?
Well, I'm just curious. If you look at the history of our country, you began to hit on it, but...
What I was going to say in response to what she was saying, she was talking about how it should be, like, all year round, and I feel in an area like this, it's much easier to do something like that, where, like, people, where we wouldn't really need to... where we don't feel the need for a Black or Hispanic History Month, because we feel like that's going on around us. But if you're going down to somewhere else, maybe somewhere like where I used to live in Tennessee, people just like don't know as much. People just don't really know as much about it. So I feel a month would actually does help in areas such as that.
Mm, interesting. So there's a regional divide that provides.
Well, there could be. I think you both hit on some excellent points about our history and who we are as a people, and maybe regionally, but for a long time in our country, whites were seen as this, you know, wonderful, almost like an uber class, you know, and everybody else was part of the mix, but not so important. And I think the history, at least in my lifetime, was that we need to honor all of us, and to give a special month was a way of honoring and respecting and elevating and having us learn about each other rather than saying, well, I don't need to pay attention to that group, or I don't need to pay attention to that group. I think what you're expressing is the ideal. I really hope in your lifetimes we get to that. And if we're there at TC already, wow. I don't think we are, but even that you're thinking that way is pretty remarkable.
I would like to agree with all three of you, actually, especially what you said, that if we can get to that in TC, that would be great, and that, you know, it should take more than just 1 month. It should be something that, you know, it's celebrated year-round. But I think that's an idea that's only in the perfect world. I don't really think that exists, because the fact that we're here right now is kind of a testament to the fact that there's still a problem.
Yeah, that there's...
If we're here right now, then obviously there's still more to be said about it. I believe this is a great step in the direction of getting people to speak up about it, become more comfortable with it. I think the first step to fixing a problem is realization. Mm-hmm. So once everybody comes within the realization that there is a problem, which most of us are, I'm gonna say there's still people that are somewhat, I don't wanna say blind, but ignoring it. I think, yeah, they're still ignoring it, but I guess this is a great step in the direction of, yeah, there is a problem.
Do you know what the next museum is gonna be open in D.C.?
No, I don't.
You don't know? You're shaking your head. Do you know the next museum?
I think I've seen it. Isn't it like African-American history?
Right, it's the Washington Monument. So the question is really related to that, isn't it? Why would we open a museum dedicated to African-Americans? And, oh, by the way, three blocks the other way is a Holocaust museum. You know, dedicated to that tragic event in our history. Do you know the great historian, Santayana? Have you ever heard that name? He used a phrase that said, if we, those who forget the lessons of history are destined to repeat them. Mm-hmm. And so I think there is something to, whether it's an African-American museum or a Holocaust museum or something, a Latino or an Asian museum, that we need to understand our roots, our history, so that we improve as a people without ignoring. I can't deny your past or your past, just as you can't deny mine, but we could respect and build a new future.
I want to say the issue with that, it's not that people are denying each other's past, it's just that history is probably written by the winners. Mm-hmm. So, you know, somebody may be overridden, if anything, but I think that's great that...
Do you know where that line is? By the way, you've seen that line. History is written by the winners.
Yeah.
Probably a thousand times. You
so
know what
times.
Poster? You know where it exists in this school?
I can't.
Remember the Titans poster with Denzel Washington? Mm-hmm. Right underneath his picture, it says history is written by the winners. That's kind of sad, by the way.
I think that might, I agree with the connotations that it has where history is written by the winners, but perhaps when you meant winners, did you mean those who are white and who have traditionally been in history books?
I mean oppressors in general. I don't want to, because there's been oppressors of every color.
I agree,
oppressors in general. I mean, whoever wins, that's going to be the person, no matter what their race or, you know, who they are, they're going to be the ones telling the story, not the losers.
And
people don't listen to losers.
It's interesting you say telling the story. So we do have history classes where our books are written to tell the story of diversity and inclusion, but then we also have these Black History, Hispanic Heritage Months, where we're trying to look at the other side. So do you think TC is doing an adequate job integrating and weaving all of these cultures together to have a fully culturally knowledgeable school? Do you feel like more should be done?
I think
there's... Or
less? I think there's pockets of people who, you know, are really enthusiastic about spreading the word, you know, making sure that it's not just a certain race, their history being pushed onto everybody else, but actual knowledge of every race, from whether it be Spanish, Asian, you know, Latino. I'm sorry if I get the two confused. I'm sorry, but you know, Black or whatever your race may be, or white, whatever your race may be. I had a teacher last year who made sure that the story was told from all angles.
Mm-hmm.
It was a great experience for me. Actually, I've had a couple teachers do that too, to be exact. But both of them, it was enriching.
So we have two students here. Do we do a good enough job here? Or should we be doing more?
Jacob.
I don't really see a problem, like with the way they do it. I don't know how to put out a way that more could be done.
Mm.
I don't really have an idea on that. Maybe Ty, you do.
Yeah, I agree with you. I don't really see much rampant racism running through mm-hmm. the halls of TC or anything. And what was the question again?
Whether or not you think more should be done in TC to educate the students on diversity throughout history, throughout their own cultures.
I think something could be done, like I guess in history class, but I really couldn't say.
Like with literature, I know we have a unit in my senior year where we read urban literature, which is traditionally by African-American authors, or we've read numerous books about the Holocaust by Jewish authors. Do you feel as if, as an Asian-American, that you would like to read a book written by an Asian-American, that should be a prominent focus?
I haven't done that in, I don't think, any of my English classes, but mostly I looked through the syllabus for my English class this year, and it's not really, the books that we read aren't really based on, like, what the race of the author was. It's based on theme or like essential question, and that, and my teacher will find a book of literary merit that best answers that question. So I don't really think of it as a matter of, oh, this author's Asian, so it's gonna answer the question better. I just think of it as like, after I read it, like, wow, this was a really good book and with really good themes and stuff like that.
That's interesting. It's moving towards this race-blind society that we're all pushing for. Now, as we move forward, I would like to invite the students to share a little bit more on this race-blind society, as well as their own experiences in TC in regards to diversity, discrimination, and inclusion and exclusion. But before we do that, I would like to thank Dr. Sherman so much for joining us and giving us the forum for this discussion. The fact that that's possible is really huge.
Thank you, Laura, for picking this topic, and enjoy the rest of your conversation.
Thank you. Yeah. To jump into the first question with the students, do you believe your race, skin color, or culture precludes who you are, and or does your race define you? If so, what are those definitions?
In some places, I think my race would preclude me. That's what you said. Yeah.
How?
Well, I'll say my race and whatever I'm wearing at that time, because you know, presentation is everything. But I think if I were to walk into a room and let's say I had really baggy jeans on and I had a basketball in my hand and maybe I had a hat on and some sneakers, I don't think it would surprise anybody. I think they would be like, oh, okay, another black guy. I think that would be something that, you know, they would accepting of. Or if I was to walk inside a room with maybe a bow tie, some really nice slacks, a blazer, and a shirt, and maybe some glasses on, you know, I think that might surprise people. Or if I was to start talking about some sort of literature or something like that, I think that would surprise people. I think people would be surprised by intelligence coming from somebody like me in certain places, not everywhere. There's cool people out there.
I think race, me being white, a lot of people, when I walk into a room, they expect me. Like here at TC, many times I've walked into a room and someone automatically assumes I'm in AP classes. Someone automatically assumes that I'm really intelligent and that I know what I'm talking about and that I know all of these things because I'm white. Mm. And that's not true. You can't define someone's intelligence by race, only by what they say and how they present themselves, like he said.
Very true.
Yeah, I've had the exact same experience being Asian, especially with math. Because that's just a huge stereotype, which is not exactly true right now. No. But yeah, like people just assume things like, oh, so you have like a 5.0, and I'm like, yeah, that's definitely not true. Or they'll say like, oh, what do you play? And I'll be like, what? And they'll be like, what instrument? And I'm like, nothing, because I don't play violin and I don't play piano. But people just assume that, and that's just not me, which is kind of obnoxious.
Right, that stereotype is almost hurtful.
Yeah, I mean, I know. I used to live in Tennessee, so sports is really big down there. And anytime you walk in there, teachers always ask you, do you play football or try out for the basketball team or something like that? And I mean, part of that might be because of my height. I'm a pretty big person, but also because of my race as well. I feel like that also has a major role in it. And I try I don't want to like sound weird here, but I try to do things that people don't expect me to do. Like what he said, I try to look nice. I try to wear like cardigans and stuff like that, blazers, bow ties. I try to, I play guitar. I've also played saxophone, piano. So I just try to do all sorts of different things that people wouldn't expect me to do.
That's interesting. You talk about an expectation placed upon your race. So what does it mean to act like a certain race, or even to be black and to act like a different race, or to be white and act like a different race? What does that mean?
For me, I've noticed that when someone white tries to act black or a different race, there comes words with it. There are slang words for it. And not with those words come a definition that's not true. Like, some people just prefer to wear a certain type of clothing because it's more comfortable. Some people prefer to talk a certain way because that's what they know. That's what they've been surrounded with. It doesn't have to do with race. It has to do with experience and comfortability. And when black people or someone like an Asian or Hispanic dress preppy, or what the stereotypical white girl or white man should look like with colored pants and a really Easter looking outfit most of the time, they're considered fake, phony, trying to be someone they're not, which isn't true. It's just what you experience and what's been brought to your attention.
Interesting.
Just to kind of put an example, you said when you first see somebody, or when somebody first sees you, they expect you to play sports. Now, I actually just saw you in the class today for the first time, and I'm going to be honest with you and tell you what I expect. Like, I sort of expected you, expect you to play sports. I don't know why.
I do play sports.
Yeah. I guess because you came in talking to somebody who played sports, so I was like, oh, she must be pretty interested into sports. We're pretty interested in sports, but I didn't expect, you know, you to be extra preppy or you to be in all AP classes. I kind of just saw you as a normal girl, you know. I guess that's just, you know, one person, but I mean, yeah.
I think that's where the diversity in TC is growing. I think that's how mentally we are changing each other, because we're surrounding each other with different experiences and aspects of people.
I completely agree. You guys have things, stereotypes, anything else you want to share? No?
Well, could you ask me the question again? Like,
yeah, that would help.
Well, I'm almost forgetting the question. So basically, what things are reserved for one race? So let's say, to put that out there, the rapper Nas, a lot of African-American people are considered to be his biggest fans. Well, if a white person or even an Asian person listens to them, they're trying to be quote-unquote down with black. Do you agree with that statement?
Yeah.
That can happen?
Yeah, like with what you said with the question, what things are like reserved for certain races. Like, you think of, like, when we think music, we think like alternative with like kind of like white teenagers. You think country music with southern people, you know what I'm talking about? So, I mean, I feel like there are definitely things that people feel, even if it's not intentional, they feel that it is reserved for a certain race.
Right.
So that's just the point I wanted to make.
I agree with him, especially with music. There's huge stereotypes behind music. My dad loves country for some reason. I can't say why. I think it has nothing to do with race. I think that's something he actually prefers. He like really legit sings country when we're driving sometimes. So I think he actually loves it. Me, I think for things that are reserved for one race, guys don't laugh, but fried chicken. People love to say that black people love fried chicken, but we all know that fried chicken is delicious. Everybody loves fried chicken or watermelon. Everybody loves watermelon, but...
Do we have someone not a watermelon fan?
Oh, no. I can't stand it. It doesn't have a taste.
Yeah, you know, I actually don't like watermelon. It's bland. It tastes like water. There's a reason they call it watermelon.
Yeah.
See, we're crossing the racial barriers right there. How does it make you feel to think that certain things are off limits, or even a certain way of speaking or dressing or liking something is, you know, not allowed because of your race?
I remember one of the first times I actually came to this school. It was one of my first days here, and I was in the lunch line, and one of the teachers didn't recognize me because I was new. So they asked me where I was from, and they started talking to me. And at the end of it, they said, "Wow, you speak like so nice." You know, I probably said that wrong, but like the way you talk, they were emphasizing that. Like, I was very punctual and stuff like that.
Eloquent,
yeah, that's a better word to use. With the way I spoke, I wasn't using slang or I was enunciating words and stuff. And I feel like people tie, you know, not doing that in with, you know, like being black.
Mm. Interesting. Do you guys agree, being not of the black race, that people assume that eloquence is for someone who's not black?
I think that people who are stuck in the past and stuck on because when Africans were first brought to this country, they weren't supposed to learn how to talk properly or read. That was illegal.
Right.
And I think that people are stuck on that and think that they're still supposed to be like that, when in all reality, they're learning the same things we are.
Right.
We're all learning together. It's not one way or another. Right. So.
I agree. Ty?
Yeah, I agree with that, and how, like, even though they've been, like, learning with us in the same area, in the same environment, people still think, like, oh, you speak well? That's so good. Like, what is that?
Right. Eloquence does not define who you are either. So moving on to what defines who you are, I held up a few Barbies at the beginning of the show and asked the audience which one they associate goodness with, or prosperity or success or wealth. This is a common test for young children to hold up a Barbie and ask them to choose which one is who they would like to be. And traditionally, students, or not students, children of darker races have chosen the lighter Barbie as the one who's most likely to succeed. Do you think that society still uses race to judge goodness or even value in a human being?
Yes.
Really? Interesting. So, expand.
I mean, I guess one time, I don't want to, sometimes I don't like to say it's because of my skin. I've kind of tried to grow out of that and think of other reasons,
mm-hmm.
but there's certain times where it's just so obvious. And I remember over break, I was leaving a coffee shop, and there was this lady on the corner, and just out of, I don't know why, I was just being polite, because you know when you make eye contact with somebody, you usually say, hi, how are you?
Mm-hmm.
So, let me describe this lady. She was a older, much older, Caucasian female. Just sitting on the corner, I don't know what she was doing, maybe waiting for somebody, maybe sitting on the corner and minding her own business.
Right.
But we made eye contact, and I decided to say hello. And she ignored me completely.
Mm-hmm.
And I was in a pretty good mood. I felt like talking. I felt like being open. And I was like, I was like, all right. So I stopped. I said, hello. And she did not look at me. She didn't turn to acknowledge me at all. And this kind of made me angry at first. I was like, okay, all right, look, I know you heard me. I'm not yelling at her, but I'm speaking loud enough to where she can hear me. And at this point, we're feet away from each other. And I say, ma'am, I'm trying to say hello. And she just nods her head, but she still hasn't looked at me yet. At this point, my friend says, let's go. And I was like, you're right, she's probably going to call the cops. That's what I said to myself. I'm going to be honest with you. And as I started walking down the street, I started getting a little scared. Like, maybe she might be calling the cops, because I've heard times before where, yo, what were you doing to that lady? I was like, I was just saying hi. And they still called the cops on him, still tried to, you know, get him up out of there. Because, you know, I don't know if it's maybe because I'm a teenager. Maybe she was afraid. There's a lot of reasons. And I'm still pretty...
upset.
Not upset, but it does bother me.
Taken aback almost?
Yeah.
Yeah, just a bit.
13, and it's still kind of like the Antebellum South a little bit.
Yeah.
Jacob, I saw you nodding your head. Do you have...
I was just thinking of... you know, something I like to call the elevator test. If you've ever like walked into an elevator with like, there's already somebody in there, and it usually with a white female, like you walk in there, you know, she'll like clutch her purse. I've just noticed that a lot. Yeah, I mean, it's something that happens. It's something you have to be aware of. I don't think a lot of people do it intentionally. I'm not even sure, because I'm not white. I don't know if she'd do it with a white person getting into an elevator, but. It's just something that I think people do, not instinctively, but they've almost been raised to think that way.
Yes. It's from birth. And you said yes when I first asked the question.
What was the question?
If society uses race to judge goodness.
Yes, I think they do, because they do it for intelligence, and they do it for school, and they do it for what you're supposed to grow up and know. When I was... I mean, I'm not going to sit here and lie to you. My grandparents are stuck in the past.
Interesting.
They are incredibly stuck in the past. And there hasn't been a time where I haven't been told going to them that I'm supposed to be a certain way, because it is my history to be the greater good of everything. I'm supposed to go to a higher college. I'm supposed to have a job that pays well. And they're stuck in the past in the sense that they automatically assume that me going to TC Williams and the white percentage is a little low here, mm-hmm. because there's other races. So yeah. They've looked up my school and they automatically assume that these other races will have an impact on my education.
Interesting.
They think that the people that are in my classes and that are of another race could possibly impact my education in the long run negatively.
Yeah, they could hinder it almost.
Yes.
Interesting. Ty?
This question actually reminded me of last year, my English teacher, he was talking with a few African-American girls about skin color within the black community and how lighter skin is mm-hmm. viewed as more attractive. And he listed Beyonce and Rihanna and a bunch of other African-American actresses with lighter skin and how they were seen as more attractive than, like, in comparison to someone who was darker. And then the African-American girls said, yeah, that's always, like, been the case, and that's why they always wear makeup to look lighter. And I just...
Yes, well, I understand.
Yeah.
The society does still judge goodness by that. And I think having all of you gathered here today is a testament, and correct me if I'm wrong, to our desire to become race blind. So the last question for today before I do ask you to share your final thought is, in a society that is race blind, how would you be perceived? Like, what is the value of a race blind society?
Value of a race blind society.
Or is it possible, better yet? Do you think we'll ever achieve that?
I don't think it's possible.
No.
I do not think it's possible. I think that we remind each other every day of what has been happened in the past. And I don't want to sit here and say that's why we shouldn't have Black History Month or that's why we shouldn't have these things that remind us of the past. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying more is the fact that it's taken in every day. Mm-hmm. Me personally, I believe that people who are white are still trying to make up for what we've done. We're still trying to apologize in our own way for enslaving people and taking that to an extreme. Mm-hmm. And I think that racism will not end because some people still do assume that we are automatically racist. We are automatically seeing one thing one way, which isn't true. And so when we do something that could possibly seem racist,
right.
It goes into court. It can impact your job. It can impact on how much money you have. It can impact on, my mother's work, they fired a black lady and she sued them because it was racist. Mm. So I think that racism will not go away because we all have our own idea of racism.
Interesting, our own idea of racism.
You know, I don't think it's a white problem. I mean, like, people think that, like, white people are automatically racist and, like, some, like she was saying, can be stuck in the past. But I also think that other races can be stuck in the past as well. I know for some, like, older black people, like, they won't want to be around white people because they'll feel like those white people are stuck in the past too, and they're going to pretty much affect the way they feel. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's just a point I wanted to add in there.
Well, my view on this, I think slavery, take it back a little bit. I think it was a well-oiled machine. I think it did exactly what the people who were in charge, the oppressors, I think it did exactly what it wanted them to. It molded our minds in a way that still affects us to today. You know, our mindset has been changed because of slavery. It's taken it to the point where certain black people think they're inferior, where a lighter skin color is more acceptable. I'll stop there.
All right. Well, unfortunately, that is all the time we have for today. I'd like to thank all of you for joining us today and for sharing your opinions, and I hope to have you on the show sometime again. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.